A Without Walls special now reveals the true story of what happened one cold December day in 1970 when Elvis, the King, met the President.
At 12:30 on December 21st, 1970, a secret meeting was held at the White House. There were no television crews in attendance and no hidden microphones to record the conversation. 28 photographs and a two-page memo are the only official account of what happened. For years, they lay hidden in the vaults of the presidential archives. For 20 minutes, Elvis Presley and Richard Nixon discussed music, babies, and the state of America. This is the story of that meeting.
Well, that's all right, Mama. That's all right with you. That's all right, Mama. Just any way you do.
American officials set their forces under Cambodia on a limited mission to deny the enemy supplies from a...
In 1970, America was at war. In spite of his election promise of peace with honor, Nixon had escalated the conflict in Vietnam, sending troops into Cambodia and Laos. And as the war intensified, so did the reaction to it. The passive protests of the mid-60s gave way to a new militant activism. The country was in turmoil.
As long as I am president, no band of violent thugs is going to keep me from going out and speaking with the American people whenever they want to hear me and whenever I want to go.
The White House was under siege, or at least Richard Nixon thought it was. He had a them arrest mentality. He holed up largely in the White House. He couldn't understand what was going on. He didn't relate at all to the young hippies who were crowding in on him.
So at the time that Elvis came to the White House in December of 1970, December 21, we were still very much in that period of great resistance to the war, resistance to the president. I think the White House staff became accustomed to, you come to work each day and drive through a group of demonstrators holding their placards. It was a very intense time for everybody.
If you're looking for trouble, you came to the right place. Looking for trouble, just look right in my face. I was born standing up and talking back. My daddy was a green-eyed man, because I'm evil.
Whilst Nixon was on the ropes, Elvis was making a comeback. He had spent most of the 60s in Hollywood, crooning his way through endless movies which he had come to hate. But now he was back. And he meant business.
So don't you mess around with me.
Journalists, rock critics, were interested in Elvis Presley as they had never been before right about this time. He was an unfinished figure at this point. Nobody quite knew what to make of him.
On the press corps that you really are a shy, humble, wonderful human being. Would you agree with that?
Paul, I don't know what makes him think that. This gold belt and the...
He came back to pick up his mantle as the king of rock and roll and continue, and found that, you know, pretenders to the throne had crept in whilst he was away and threatened his position. And indeed, by 1969, certainly, Mick Jagger was being called the king of rock and roll.
Sing it!
The rock world had changed. While Elvis was playing Las Vegas, 500,000 hippies were rolling around in the Woodstock mud, singing along to anti-war anthems.
Oh, Mr. Presley, on the subject of the service, what is your opinion of war protesters, and would you today refuse to be drafted?
Honey, I just seem to keep my own personal views about that to myself. I'm just an entertainer, and I'd rather not say.
I never looked for trouble, but I never ran.
In spite of his bad boy image, Elvis's patriotic credentials had never been in doubt. In 1958, at the height of his career, he had been drafted and done his duty in the Army.
Wear truth, faith, and allegiance.
He was as much patriotic as John Wayne was.
The United States of America.
He really didn't like the people that were always speaking bad about the country, this country. That's the way he was. I mean, he was a throwback to that kind of thought process regarding this country. And any group that put it down, whether it be the Black Panthers or whoever else that racially motivated or whatever, if they attacked this country, Elvis was against them and didn't like them.
And Elvis was a supporter of the police. He had given thousands of dollars to police charities and had been awarded honorary badges.
They wanted to give him these honorary credentials, and he didn't want honorary. He wanted them to be real. He wanted the real badge with the real ID stating that he was a law enforcement officer in that county or that city or wherever it may be. And he just started collecting them. Then he got us our badges here in Shelby County so that we could carry weapons in the county around home here while we were here protecting him.
We went to Palm Springs and we got deputized there. And we got badges here in Los Angeles and Denver, Colorado, where we spent some time in the winter. And so he really got into it.
But it was in Los Angeles that Elvis would meet an actor who would set him off on the trail of the ultimate badge. Paul Friess was a voiceover artist who moonlighted as a consultant for the Bureau of Narcotics and Dangerous Drugs, and he had a badge to prove it.
And I saw Elvis just light up when he saw that badge that Paul Friess showed him. A legitimate narcotics badge. And he said he had to have one.
As a collector, this was the ultimate badge, you know. This had to come from Washington. This superseded any other badge. And for a year, Elvis planned on how to get one of these.
But this was more than just a badge. The BNDD were Nixon's frontline troops in the war against drugs, and Elvis wanted to join the fight. So forget the sleeping pills, forget the pep pills, forget all the pills he took on prescription. It was time to get those hard drugs off the street.
He had a very big thing against heroin and cocaine and stuff on the street and getting to these people. And he wanted to get the people that off the streets that were doing it. He went on a drug bus right there in Memphis one night in disguise. I actually went on one with the police and everything.
A meeting was set up between Elvis and John Finlater, deputy director of the BNDD. Elvis's journey from Graceland to Washington had all the hallmarks of an undercover operation.
I was sitting in the dining room with some of the guys and everything, Marty and them, and Vernon came in, his father, thinking Elvis was in there with us, and he wasn't, and he asked where he was, and we said, upstairs, you know, he hadn't come down. And he went up there and he wasn't upstairs. So that's how we found out he was gone. And I start thinking, what in the world is going on? What do you mean he's gone? You know, I don't know what he, we're not thinking yet that he's gone and flown somewhere. I mean, is he gone and got out in the car and left and went for a ride or whatever? I don't know, I just thought, gone, where'd he go?
Traveling under the name of John Burroughs, Elvis flew from Memphis to Washington and checked into a hotel in the center of town.
That is the only time that he flew anywhere by himself. He didn't know how to do things. He did not know phone numbers. He couldn't tell you his home in Graceland, the number, or at his house, or anywhere. He couldn't tell you the room number he was in a hotel. He didn't know any of these things. These were all things, that details that were taken care of by someone else.
Elvis had barely settled into his room when he made an impetuous decision. He would fly to Los Angeles and hook up with his friend Jerry Schilling.
The phone rang, I guess it was like 1 or 2 at night. I was asleep. And I said, you know, who is this? And he says, it's me. So I said, oh, Elvis, what are you doing? I knew exactly who it was. And that was unusual, too. He didn't pick up the phone a whole lot and call people either. He wanted to know if I would pick him up at the airport. But he didn't want anyone in the world to know where he was.
4 hours and 2,000 miles later, Elvis arrived at Los Angeles Airport and was limousined away to his bolt hole in Beverly Hills. There, he set about persuading Jerry Schilling to return with him to Washington.
He had told me a story about coming out. A steward on the flight had told him he would have to take Elvis's gun. And Elvis got extremely upset, walked off the plane, and the pilot came out, said, "Mr. Presley, it's okay. You can bring your gun on board." So I was really concerned about Elvis's well-being. He could get in a lot of trouble, especially by himself.
Well, I'm leaving town, baby. I'm leaving town to show.
That night, Elvis and Jerry returned to the airport for the red-eye flight to Washington. It was only then that his full plan emerged.
Elvis asked me if he could get some stationery. And I said, yeah, I think, you know, they used to have some on a plane. And I was a little shocked at that, because I think Elvis has written probably four, maybe five letters in his entire life. And three of them were when he was in the Army. So I thought, well, this is cool. So I asked the stewardess, and she brought back some American Airlines stationery.
Dear Mr. President, first I would like to introduce myself. I am Elvis Presley and admire you and have great respect for your office. The drug culture, the hippie elements, the SDS, Black Panthers, etc., do not consider me as their enemy, or as they call it, the establishment. I call it America, and I love it. Sir, I can and will be of any service that I can to help the country out. I have done an in-depth study of drug abuse and communist brainwashing techniques, and I'm right in the middle of the whole thing where I can and will do the most good. I would love to meet you just to say hello if you're not too busy. Respectfully, Elvis Presley.
Arriving in Washington the next morning, Elvis and Jerry jumped straight into a waiting limousine.
I tell the guy, you know, take us to the Washington Hotel. And Elvis said, no, I want to go by the White House first. I said, you know, don't you want to freshen up or whatever? He said, no, I want to drop off this letter. And I tried to talk him out of it. And he said, no, I want to drop this letter off now.
Two hours later, the letter arrived on the desk of Dwight Chapin, President Nixon's appointment secretary.
I read it. And then I called Bud Krogh, who was in charge of the domestic council and in charge of the drug program for the president. I called Bud and said, "There, I have a letter here from the king." And Bud wonders, you know, the king of what?
I said, "King who?" I said, "There aren't any kings on the president's schedule today." He said, "No, not just any two-bit king. The king, the king of rock, Elvis Presley's right here." Now, when I first heard this from Dwight Chapin, I didn't believe him. Dwight and I belonged to a group of White House staff people who were very close friends. We regularly played practical jokes on each other. And I thought this was an elaborate practical joke that Dwight was playing on me.
I wish not to be given a title or an appointed position. I can and will do more good if I were made a federal agent at large. And I will help out by doing it my way through my communications with people of all ages. I am glad to help, just so long as it is kept very private.
None of us believed that it was true. And once we became aware that, in fact, it was true, the brains started rolling in terms of what do we do to best take advantage of this opportunity? How do we make certain that Elvis Presley doesn't use the opportunity to exploit the president? Rather, how can we use this opportunity to advance an important public policy?
One, two, three.
We see the moment when a young American has to look his parents or a friend or a doctor in the face and say, "I'm hooked. I'm a drug addict." Then we see drug abuse as the slow and insidious living death of a human being who learned too late that getting high is the first step toward the lowest kind of degradation.
The people in the Nixon administration who had responsibility for this sort of thing, people who were running the FCC, the Federal Communications Commission, Spiro Agnew gave speeches denouncing rock and roll and drug songs, and even got some of the speechwriters to dig up songs like Puff the Magic Dragon, he thought were about drugs, or they thought were about drugs. the connection was almost total in the way the media presented rock and roll.
Tell me why, now tell me.
The drug rock community has its own form of class structure. At the top are the major rock artists. Many of them are on hard drugs. Down the scale are people like this local rock group manager, trying to play it big time and hoping he can make it by recording drug songs and by turning on.
The administration spokespeople or spokespersons on drug policy or anything else at that time were inherently non-credible. Nobody believed them. Government didn't have a real good record for veracity over the previous few years. So having somebody like Elvis Presley come in and offer to help out in his own way, reaching the public that he could reach, was a tremendous benefit to us, as we saw it at the time.
I've been looking for trouble. You came to the right place.
That morning, Elvis went alone to the Bureau of Narcotics and Dangerous Drugs, but John Finlater refused to give him a badge. Back at the Washington Hotel, Jerry Schilling was the first to hear the good news that Elvis's meeting with Nixon had been approved.
I called Elvis at Finlater's office, and he got on the phone, and he was really down. I mean, so I said, what's wrong? He said, well, I'm not doing any good here. And I thought, well, you know, it's, I said, well, we just got a call, and the president wants to meet you in 20 minutes. And he said, great. I mean, his attitude just changed. He said, be out in front of the hotel. I'll come by and pick you up on the way.
Earlier that day, Jerry Schilling had contacted Graceland, and Elvis's bodyguard, Sonny West, was sent down on the first flight. He arrived at the hotel just in time.
Here comes Elvis around with his limousine driver, Ben was his name. We got in, I said, hey, boss. He smiled, did that little old smile of his, said, son, we're gonna go see the Prez, man. I said, I'm gonna get that badge.
When they came back to the White House, I got a call from the Secret Service. One of the agents said, Bud, we've got a little problem. I said, what's that? He said, well, Elvis has brought a gun to give the president. It's a very nice gun. It's in a display case with silver bullets. Bud, you know, we can't let him take that into the Oval Office. I said, I'll be right there. And when I got there, the Secret Service had taken custody of the gun. And basically just had to explain to Elvis that no guns in the Oval Office is standard policy around here.
You know, when you really intelligently look back and think, here we're going to see the president with a gun, I don't think that would ever happen today. And I don't think it would happen with anybody but Elvis Presley.
Resplendent in a purple velvet suit, a diamond-tipped cane, and a gold belt from Las Vegas, Elvis entered the Oval Office for his meeting with Richard Nixon.
The meeting opened with pictures taken of the president and Elvis Presley.
When we walked across to the desk, I mean, Elvis was clutching these badges from various police departments, and then he had two pictures with him, one of Lisa Marie and one of Priscilla. He placed these on the president's desk, and the president came around the desk and was, or stood there at the edge of the desk, and Elvis began to go through them, and the president picked up the pictures, and I remember there was one of Lisa Marie in a baby bonnet. The president looks at me and says, oh, she's a beautiful little girl, and Elvis smiled, and then he leaned over and he pulled back his cuffs and started showing the president his cufflinks, and the president leans over and said, oh, very nice cufflinks. These were cufflinks that he had been given by the vice president at some place, so I'm not sure this was a hint that maybe you could give me, do better than these.
The president mentioned that he thought Presley could reach young people and that it was important for Presley to retain his credibility. Presley responded that he did his thing by just singing.
The actual discussion did not follow any clear pattern. He said, well, you know, Mr. President, the Beatles are kind of anti-American. And presidents are looked at me like they are. Then he brought up another subject. He said, you know, Mr. President, there's been a loss of respect for the flag. And the president could somewhat agree to that. And Elvis said that he'd made a study of communist brainwashing. And that was getting into a subject that I didn't see any hope of finding any commonality. We didn't have a communist brainwashing program underway, so there wasn't much he could do with us on that issue. What I thought was happening here was Elvis was trying to find things to say that would align himself with the president. Basically, almost saying, I can be an emissary for some of the ideas that that you believe in, but obviously have to keep my credibility, which the president said, yeah, I'll make sure you keep your credibility. Don't let anybody know you were here.
The president then indicated that those who use drugs are also those who are in the vanguard of anti-American protest. Violence, drug usage, dissent, protest, all seem to merge in generally the same group of young people.
And then Elvis asked the question. He said, well, Mr. President, can you get me a badge from the Bureau of Narcotics? And the president turned to me, because this is something that we had not anticipated, and I hadn't written in the talking points for the president. And he said, well, Bud, can we get him a badge? I said, well, sir, if you want to get him a badge, we can get him a badge. He said, well, make sure that he gets one. I want him to get one.
So Bud Krogh called over to me and said, Jeff, call over to the Justice Department and get a BNDD badge. I said, sure enough. So I called John Finletter, the director of the Bureau of Narcotics and Dangerous Drugs, and I said, John, President Nixon is meeting with Elvis Presley. Well, first there was a disbelief. I said, no, John, this is really happening. And the president wants to give Elvis a BNDD badge. John said, well, we can't do that. I said, why not? He said, well, Elvis isn't an agent. He can't have a badge. I responded, John, you don't understand. The leader of the Western world wants Elvis Presley to have a BNDD badge. Get me a damn badge.
Elvis, at that point, stepped forward, and I believe it was in his left arm. He grabs the president, and he hugs him. And president hugging was not a commonplace in the Oval Office, at least in my limited experience. And Mr. Nixon, as many people know, is a very formal person. And being hugged by a guest was probably not foremost in his mind when he went to work that day. And as I observed this hug, I got to thinking this may well be the last meeting they're going to let me schedule. After the hug was over, Elvis stepped back and he said, Mr. President, would you have some time to meet a couple of my friends who are here? It would mean a great deal to them. The president turned to me and said, well, Bud, do we have time for that? I wasn't sure what the right answer to that question was. But, I mean, we were in so deep by that time, I said, sure, we've got time for that. I'll go get him.
We opened the door, and I kind of slide into the right, and Jerry kind of slides in beside me. We're kind of up against the wall. We don't just walk in. This is the Oval Office. It's holy ground. And Elvis says, come on, guys. And he pulls us on into the room. And he said, Mr. President, here's my guys. And he comes around his desk and comes up. And I'm standing here, and he hit me on the shoulder. I said, you got a couple of big ones here. They take good care of you. And he says, oh, yes, sir, they sure do.
I remember him hitting me on the shoulder kind of like a guy, you know, and saying, well, you got some pretty big guys here, Elvis.
And after they'd shaken hands and talked for a while, the president went behind his desk to get some gifts. And this was a customary thing that the president would do. And it was in the bottom drawer of his desk. And he opened the drawer, and in that were gifts that were sort of lined up according to the importance of the visitor. And Elvis was overcome with curiosity as to what was in that drawer. And one of my abiding memories of this meeting is Elvis walking behind the desk, bending over that drawer with the president, and they're rooting through this drawer together. And out come the paperweights and the pen knives.
He comes up and he gives us these 14-karat gold keychains with the presidential seal. Hands one to Jerry and to myself. And we thank you very much. And Elvis looks at him and said, Mr. President, they got wives, too. So he said, oh, okay. So he goes back and he comes back with these presidential seal pendants.
They left loaded down, and I think everybody was very pleased with what they'd been given.
And so ended one of the strangest days in the legendary life of Elvis Presley. Elvis left the White House with his treasured badge and soon received the credentials of a special assistant to the BNDD. In the years that followed, there were speeches from the stage denouncing drugs and rumors of undercover operations, but never again would he meet Richard Nixon.
That badge meant to Elvis Presley that not only was he respected as an entertainer, he was respected as an American. This was probably the ultimate personal thing outside of his career.
Elvis never went anywhere without that badge once he got it, the federal credentials and badge. He never went anywhere that wasn't with him. If it wasn't on his person in a pocket, it was in a little case that they carried his jewelry and stuff around in, it was in there, but it was always with him.
The thing that was extraordinary was that no one talked about this meeting. President didn't, I didn't talk to the White House press corps or anyone on the Ron Ziegler staff. It remained secret for 13 months.
How would you describe your meeting with Elvis?
My daughters knew him and heard him. I didn't know that much about him except what I had read. But as I talked to him, I sensed, too, that basically he's a very shy man. The flamboyance was covering up the shyness. He was also a very sincere man. He wanted to be an example to young people. And people say that because later on it was found that he had used drugs, that therefore he could not be a good example. They overlooked the fact that he never used illegal drugs. It was always drugs prescribed by his physician. But I think that he was a very sincere and decent man.
Elvis Forever continues tonight with Rob Youngblood as Elvis and Beau Bridges as the Colonel, his manager, the power behind the throne, and the man who ruthlessly exploited the King's talents. A friendship forged over the years and now put to the test by...
Okay, we fly!